We'll keep you updated on this, but time to get back to New York, where Kay and the gang are hanging out with a Giants player who did not take a picture with my mother, Rashad Jennings.
That's right, Rashad Jennings is in the house. I'm hanging out here with the guru. I'm full of wine and Italian food, thankful of the Scotto family for stopping by. And on his bye week stopping by is New York Giants running back Rashad Jennings. Welcome in, guys. Thank you very much. Have a seat, have a seat. Go ahead.
Well, you know, the first question is, way back in your rookie year in 2009, I went down to Jacksonville. I interviewed Maurice Jones-Drew. I had a magazine. And, of course, I knew all about you. I knew that you were a prospect to watch out for. But he had only been on the team for like a month. And he really talked very highly of you. So I would assume, because he's a good dude, I know him, I work with him at SiriusXM.
Me too, yeah.
Was he a big influence on you? What did MJD do for you as you entered the league?
He was huge to my career. I remember coming in as a rookie. He was somebody I lived with prior to getting drafted because we had shared the same agent, shared the same financial advisor. So I trained with him in the offseason before I ever was drafted. We had no idea I was going to get drafted to the same team.
Wow.
And he kind of took me under his wing and taught me like the ins and outs of the NFL.
Yeah.
Well, there's a big difference between Jacksonville and New York City, and now you're up here playing for the Giants. Can you describe your role in this backfield as sort of a three-headed, four-headed monster?
Yeah, so for me, you know, I go in this season every single year with the same mentality. That's prepare like a starter, no matter where you are on the depth. And that's to find ways to contribute to the team. So for me, you know, my job as athletes is to protect the quarterback, to get those ugly yards, to catch the ball when it's thrown to him, find a way to make plays.
Yeah.
And that necessarily doesn't even always have to be on offense.
You forgot one thing, Rashad, and that's the fact that you blocked a punt this year. That's definitely a way to contribute to your team. And I think we even have footage of that because we were like, what? That's incredible. Can you take me through that moment?
Yeah, so I'm going back to backing up Maurice. You know, he's a machine and never came off the field.
That's
so
right.
as a rookie, I said, look, I got to figure out how to make a team. So blocking punts and catching the ball out the backfield kind of was my niche as a younger back.
Nice.
And I never lost that technique of how to block punts.
Now back to the role, though, because last year I was very high on you for fantasy. Moving on to the new team, you had a really clear role. Not as much this year because I just wasn't sure the addition of Shane Vereen and all that. And you were recently very hard on yourself in an interview that I read that you gave yourself an F for this year. But the problem that I have, and the fantasy owners, you're probably frustrated. Well, we're frustrated that you don't get the ball enough, quite frankly. You're getting 10 carries a game. And you're a running back. You want the rock, and you need to get into a rhythm. And that's got to be difficult, not getting the ball enough.
You know, you find ways as an athlete. You find ways to make plays for the carries you get, the touches you do get. And, you know, obviously as a running back you do, or any player, I'm pretty sure you can vouch and say they want the ball in their hands.
Sure.
But, you know, I got to maximize and take advantage of the ones that I get. And it's not about an individual, you know. I think our group, as a backfield, we see ourselves as a collective unit.
Right.
No individuals in the backfield. So our body of unit is doing well.
Rashad, it's just you and me here. Nobody else is listening. Did what he just said make you upset, like, inside, to hear about fantasy owners and what we care about? Like, we're like, we're yeah. frustrated because you're not getting the ball enough. Do you hate fantasy football in general? Do you play? Do your teammates play?
Nah, there's no hate. I it brings a whole another recognition to the game.
Yeah.
But, you know, obviously we dehumanized. And I will say this to fantasy owners.
We're dehumanized.
If you're the owner and we're doing bad, then you probably should do a better job and fire us.
Wow.
You know, I mean, this is your team. So you probably should get your
team. Well, that would explain why I was very high on Rashad last year, but not as much this year. Because I wasn't sure about your role. But by the way, during your bye week, the Eagles lost today. I'm sure that's a real shame, right? So you gained some ground on your bye week from the Eagles.
We're definitely fortunate enough to be leading our division. The division is open right now. You know, we one game at a time. Everything is right in front of us. We just got to stay tunnel vision and be able to fight for the last game against Philly.
What percentage of your teammates or people that you know that play in the NFL play fantasy football?
It's a good amount. You know, I ain't going to say no names, but
just
somewhere.
Just a percentage, 1 to 100.
1 through 100 percentage, maybe. It's maybe a little bit over 50.
Over 50% okay. Play fantasy football. That's very, very interesting.
Now,
I love that.
I want to ask about, you were a seventh round pick I watched her at the Senior Bowl. I think all fantasy owners, by the way, if you really want to start your offseason scouting, because that's how I knew about you that week at the Senior Bowl. But you talked about how, you know, you were a seventh-round pick. Someone believed in you, and your family was involved. And, you know, there's a lot of people kind of behind you. So just talk about the people who've helped you come this far in the NFL.
Yeah, there's no doubt, no question about it, my two older brothers and family. You know, they're two men who they're in their 10 and 13 years older than me.
Wow.
And, you know, I was just a little chubby, overweight, you know, 0.6 GPA average, fifth string running back at one point in time. And, you know, my brothers truly believed in me before I really realized who I was. And if it wasn't for them pushing me, if it wasn't for them making a sacrifice and going to a private school and coaching and teaching there for free to pay a tuition for me to transfer and repeat, I wouldn't be here having this conversation.
Where do you get the work ethic? Because I know this for a fact. Last year, you were in insane shape. Even this past summer, like every NFL player reports to training camp, well, most of them, in great shape. But to me, you're like a notch above. Like you, to me, you've got a great work ethic. Where'd you get that from?
Just because, you know, authentic to not rolling out of bed and having the most talent. I really, truly had to work at it. And because of that, I have a great appreciation.
Nice.
Now, if you weren't playing football, and congratulations on all the success that you have had and for the rest of the season, a little birdie told me that you would want to be a marriage counselor. Is that true? Why? What?
A lot of wisdom right here.
Yeah, so for me, there's so many things I want to dedicate in myself to in life, you know, outside the lines of football. And I look at that at the latter years of committing myself to marriage counseling, because why? I think it's beautiful. I think it's sacred. And I've seen so many failed ones that if I could actually implant any kind of give back to society, would be in that arena.
Now, I saw you also doing some research. You have your own furniture line from Bob's Discount Furniture.
You're like very ottoman, interesting.
You got like an
Josh
ottoman is. Named after you. What's up
with
that?
Yeah, the Jennings is a power reclining chair. It's
right.
A whole tie couch. It's nice. You got to get one, man.
It sounds incredible.
It sounds comfortable.
It's awesome.
It sounds like a good thing. Now, you're also doing some philanthropy as well, and you have a comedy night coming up.
Yes, I do. So, for me, I'm a lover of life. I think humor is a medicine. You know, smiles and laughter from all different cultures are the same. So, I wanted to come together and surround ourselves around laughter. Going to year 7 in the NFL, I've seen so many different kind of events. And for me, we all laugh. So us getting together for a John Knighter comedy, I thought would be fitting.
This is the first one, too.
Yes, this is the very first one. All funds are going to the Rashad Jennings Foundation to fund all the different programs we have.
Nice.
So people can get tickets to this. It's Monday, November 30th, just so you guys know, 6:30 to 8:30 in New York. There's a meet and greet cocktail reception, so you can go and actually meet people. I'm sure your teammates will be there as well. There's a comedy show. It's at Gotham Comedy Club on 23rd Street. You can get all the information, I'm sure, by following
stand
you
up.
On Twitter.
You going to do some stand-up?
You have to.
I might do some poetry.
Yeah.
You write poetry?
I do, yes. That's I do poetry. True. Every
all
season.
It's all in the delivery. It's all in the delivery, and I would imagine that would apply to poetry. So get your reps in.
I'm ready. No worries.
You've got John Melendez, who we've all seen on The Tonight Show with Jay Leno. He's incredible.
Yeah.
And I think we had a flyer up as well. I'm sure if you go to @DirecTV, we will tweet out that information for you guys to attend this comedy night, which is for such a great cause. Congratulations on all the success and good luck the rest of the season. Thanks for coming.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
All right, Jason Smith, what you got?
I got stuff for you, Kay. I got highlights. I got Spencer Ware. Jarkandrick West being looked at on the sideline for an injury. And here he goes. 52 yards up the middle of the field. Takes a host and a bevy of players to bring him down. And that Spencer Ware run led to this Spencer Ware run. In the end zone from 3 yards out, Ware, 8 for 72 and a touchdown. This guy won the Super Bowl in 13 with the Seattle Seahawks, was out of football a year ago. A name to remember for your waiver wire. Meanwhile, in Green Bay, Aaron Rodgers looking for the hoodie. James Jones with the big catch, 5 for 82 on the day. That's a 37-yard grab for James Jones, which led to this on the first play of the fourth quarter. Aaron Rodgers looking, why not? Look for the hoodie. Touchdown, James Jones. When I see him with the hood, I feel like I'm back in high school, and when you wore your own clothes to football practice to stay warm, I got to wear the sweatshirt. I only have one with a hood, so that's okay. Touchdown, Green Bay, extra point pending. So we take you from cold Minnesota to warm San Diego, although not too warm for the Chargers. They're down 26-3, 4.5 to go in the fourth quarter.
What to do?